Today's webinar on updates on hypertension, dyslipidemia, and diabetes management. At Alchem, it has always been our endeavor to partner with healthcare professionals, and we continue to do so. Today, we have with us Dr. Aman Mukhija, Senior Cardiologist, Dr. Kunal Gupta, practicing diabetologist, to share their perspectives on hypertension and diabetes management. To help us to navigate through the meeting, we have with us today Dr. S. K. Gupta, who will be our moderator for today's webinar. We take this opportunity to welcome Dr. S. K. Gupta, MD, CFM Trends. Dr. S. K. Gupta is Senior Consultant Physician, associated with Max Patparkar Hospital, and has his own setup at East Delhi, Sri Lanka. He has more than 30 years of experience. He has a special interest in academic activities, especially in hypertension and diabetes. He was the organizing chairman of ABPA Con 2019. We request Dr. S.K. Gupta to introduce our galaxy of speakers for the day. We will now invite Dr. S.K. Gupta to set the context of this webinar and introduce our panel who will share their views, perspectives on their topic.
Thank you, Mr. Arun, and welcome you all to this webinar. And we are going to take up the issues in hypertension and diabetes, though these topics are pretty old. But despite all the newer advancements, we physicians at times get stuck up in the management of these modalities. And a lot of new changes have taken place in the last few days only. And the American Diabetic Association has released new guidelines on the diabetes management. And to talk on hypertension, we have a senior cardiologist with us, Dr. Aman Mukhija. He is a cardiologist par excellence, and he is working with the Gangaram Hospital. And he is an electrophysiologist. There are not many electrophysiologists all over Delhi. And he is one of those certified electrophysiologist, and he has more than 12 years of experience. He is in DM in cardiology, and he'll be talking on how to achieve good goals and near target therapy in patients with hypertension, especially those who have resistant hypertension or refractory hypertension. And we have with us Dr. Kunal Gupta. He is a physician par excellence. He has completed his MBBS from Faridkot and is MD in medicine from Manipal Institute. And he'll be talking about what is latest in the diabetes, how do we manage in the current scenario, and what are the difficult situations for the management of diabetes. And now I hand over the mic to Dr. Aman Mukhija to start his presentation on how to achieve aggressive goals in the patients with hypertension, especially the difficult patients. Over to Dr. Mukhija.
Am I audible?
You are audible, doctor.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gupta, for the kind words. Can I have my slides, please? Is someone displaying my slides?
No, sir, you have to share it from your own, sir.
No, but it was already uploaded, no? So. I thought it was uploaded and the other person is supposed to.
That is that.
Yeah. Okay, so the slides are visible. My topic is how to achieve aggressive blood pressure control goal in difficult to treat patients. I'll be discussing the few basic details and the modalities, which is known to most of us, but just to emphasize a few points. So, as we know that high blood pressure is the most common factor for the risk of for the cause of death among the non-communicable diseases, whether it's in the low-income group countries or whether it's in the high-income group countries, including India. It is in fact higher than diabetes, smoking, and other risk factors for non-communicable diseases. So blood pressure control is one of the most important, and of course I would say one of the most under-treated parts As per a paper which was presented in CSI 2018 from AIIMS, one out of every five young adults in India have high blood pressure. Now the problem here is that and also the as we decrease the systolic decrease the blood pressure, there is a linear relationship between decrease in blood pressure and the decrease in MACE events, that is the major cardiovascular events. That for every 10 millimeter reduction in blood pressure, there is a reduction in cardiovascular events by about 20%, a 30% improvement in mortality, about 17% increase in CAD, stroke, heart failure, as well as some improvement in chronic kidney disease as well. The issue with blood pressure is the awareness is very poor. If we talk of the urban population, it's about 42% awareness. For the rural population, it is much lower. Among the people who are aware, who are actually being treated for blood pressure, it's even worse. For urban population, only 38% of the patients who are aware are being treated. And of those 38%, hardly 20% have their blood pressure under control. And the situation in rural population is even worse. So what we're seeing is a very, is only the tip of the iceberg. The actual population, actual problem of high blood pressure is really massive and needs to be controlled on a larger and a more effective scale. Coming to the topic per se, difficult to treat hypertension. Let's define certain terms. What is uncontrolled hypertension? Means when the blood pressure is above the goal of 140-90 or say 130-80 in patients with diabetes or CKD. We next come to resistant hypertension. This is said when the office blood pressure remains above the goal in the presence of three or more antihypertensives, including a diuretic, or the patient often requires a fourth antihypertensive as well, and still the blood pressure is not controlled. That is called as a resistant hypertension. Refractory is when the patient is on five or more different antihypertensives, including a diuretic, and still the pressures are not within control. Difficult to treat hypertension term as such is less well defined and includes patients who are on multiple medications that may or may not contain a diuretics, and the blood pressure usually not up to the desired goal. Possible causes of difficult to control hypertension. One of the most important is the patient-led factors like non-adherence to antihypertensive medications, or if they are drug intolerant, or sometimes the medications are unresponsive to certain medications. There are certain secondary causes of hypertension. We all know whether it may be hormonal causes, renal artery stenosis. Sometimes the patient have labile hypertension. Sometimes the patient have hypertension alternating with hypotension, especially in patients with autonomic involvements. Patients sometimes are on concomitant medications which raise the blood pressure, especially non-steroidal antiinflammatory drugs, oral contraceptives, steroids, excessive salt intake, and of course white coat hypertension is often a underdiagnosed cause of hypertension. Certain drugs which tend to raise the blood pressure, I have already told, it could be NSAIDs, contraceptives, steroids. Secondary cause of hypertension, which should always be considered in patients who have difficult, in which the blood pressure control is difficult. The endocrine causes like hyperaldosteronism, thyroid disorders, pheochromocytoma, Cushing's. Sleep apnea is a very, very common cause of uncontrolled hypertension, which is often overlooked. And it's seen commonly in obese, but sometimes even in patients who have only high normal or slightly higher BMI. Then renovascular and renal parenchymal disease is another very common cause, and coarctation in certain cases also causes secondary hypertension. Now, if you come to the guidelines, so as per the earlier guidelines, what has changed in the recent guidelines, especially from the European Society of Cardiology, and the American guidelines are somewhat similar. So the emphasis has shifted from an office BP measurement to a repeated, either a repeated office BP measurements or a home BP measurements, either with a machine which the patient has, which should be the machine should be okay, like it should be checked in the office that the machine is okay and not giving a erroneous reading, or you have an ambulatory beep monitoring. So the emphasis has shifted from office to probably a home BP measurement. The treatment thresholds have become more aggressive. For patients, normally for hypertension of grade 1 or more means systolic BP of more than 140 or a diastolic more than 90, it should always be, along with lifestyle measures, the drug treatment should be initiated. But even for patients who have high normal blood pressures, that is between systolic between 130 to 139 and diastolic between 85 to 90, drug treatment may be considered when the CV risk is high because of either established CVD, and especially in the setting of coronary artery disease. The treatment thresholds have also become a bit aggressive. In all patients who are, this is basically applicable for adult patients. For adult patients with grade 1 hypertension or more, systolic BP more than 140 should be treated with a drug treatment. And the treatment goal is to, initial goal to bring the systolic BP of to below 140 and ideally below 130. But should not be brought below 120 because that leads to hypertensive symptoms and other problems. Similarly, the goal for diastolic blood pressure is to bring it to below 80, but not below 70. For elderly populations, means between 65 to 80, anything more than 140 should be treated. However, we do not try to achieve a systolic blood pressure below 130 in these patients, because of risk of orthostatic hypotension. For patients who are very elderly, means above 80, octogenarians, again, the systolic BP target is 130 to 139. However, we tend to start blood pressure medications in this only above 150. Diastolic BP target, as I've all told, is less than 80. And this is important that it is recommended to initiate antihypertensive treatment with a two-drug combination, preferably in a single pill combination, in most of the patients, because I will come to that why it is like that. And except for patients who are very frail or very elderly or low body weight or who have only grade 1 hypertension without any risk factors. And for the resistant hypertension, I'll come a bit later, how do you treat that? So the office BP threshold for starting treatment is anything more than 140, should be systolic or a diastolic more than 90, should be started treatment except in very elderly more than 80 years, in which the cutoff is more than 160. And the blood pressure level that we want to achieve are between 120 to 130 in most of the patients, except in the very elderly population and maybe in chronic kidney disease, in which 130 to 140 is more acceptable, and diastolic of between 70 to 80 in all these patients. So the treatment targets are now more aggressive, and there's a emphasis on using a combination therapy right at the outset. A word about ambulatory BP monitoring, which has been emphasized in these guidelines. They have numerous advantages over a single office BP measurement. It gives us a large number of readings, provides BP profile. It is especially useful to diagnose white coat hypertension, ambulatory hypotension, when patient has BP fluctuations, BP blood pressure in elderly, and also to look whether there is any nocturnal dappers or not, because that has important prognostic significance. We can omit these slides. Yeah. So the lifestyle changes, we all know, it includes weight loss, maintaining a good body mass index, then a diet rich in fruits, vegetables, and low-fat dairy products, reduce dietary sodium intakes, regular aerobic physical activities for at least 30 minutes most days of the week, and moderation of alcohol intake. We should emphasize the patient adherence and try to explain to them the need for a regular drug intake, to not to miss the pills. A word about combination therapy, why it is important. All the major trials, whether ASCOT, ALHERT, RINAL, Wilkie-Pedia, they all require two or more medications to achieve the blood pressure control. And even then, the systolic blood pressures that was achieved was in the range of 120 to 137. And most of the guidelines now recommend using a combination therapy. It has multiple benefits like greater reduction in blood pressure, better blood pressure response and control rate, reduced adverse events, adverse effects because of the lower dose of the individual drugs, and a fixed dose single pill combination will reduce the pill burden, so improves the compliance, decrease the cost as well. And the only disadvantage means there is some loss of flexibility in dose adjustments. Otherwise, they are the treatments of choice. So how do we start? Patient is usually started on a combination of either an ACE or an ARB with usually a CCB or a diuretic in a single pill combination. And if it is not controlled, then the third entity of the three is added. If the, still the blood pressures are not controlled, then they start falling into this category of resistant hypertension. Then it is mandatory to add a mineral receptor antagonist like spironolactone in the dose of 25 to 50 milligram once daily. You can also add other diuretics as well, but patient is usually on chlorothalidone or hydrochlorothiazide in the above combinations. Alpha blockers or beta blockers can be added over and above spironolactones. And beta blockers have a very specific role, though they are not the first line hypertensive, but they can be added any time, especially if there are specific indications like in heart failure, angina, post-MI, history of atrial fibrillation, or young patients with high symptomatic drive or during pregnancy. So these are the indications which beta blockers can be and should be added in any of the at any of the steps. So a stepwise approach to management of resistant hypertension. First, we have to confirm whether the patient has resistant hypertension by repeated office or ambulatory BP measurements. If it is high, we initially add spironolactone. And if still it is not controlled, then we can add beta blockers, alpha blockers, centrally acting sympatholytics, or direct vasodilators. These are some of the drugs which are added as a fourth line or fifth line. The alpha blockers like prazosin, centrally acting sympatholytics like clonidine and methyldopa, and directly acting vasodilators like hydralazine, minoxidil. Hydralazine is commonly now available with the nitrate combinations. And of course, we have to rule out secondary cause of hypertension and use these multiple drugs in combination, and we should be able to achieve blood pressure control in most of these patients. We should always emphasize the importance of BP control to the patient, the risk of the importance of lifestyle measures. And we can just omit the same thing, we will repeat it. And for diabetes specifically, it's like diabetes is considered as CAD equivalent. So anything which is applicable for coronary disease is also applicable for diabetes. So antihypertensive drug therapy is recommended when the BP is more than 140-90. And the goal is below 130, usually in the range of 120 to 130, and a diastolic in the range of 70 to 80. And of course, ACE or ARB are recommended, especially if the patient has microalbuminuria or some sort of a early renal involvement. And I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Makhija. You had nearly covered all the things, and if something is left, we are going to take up it in the question and answer session. Now I request Dr. Kunal to come up with the presentation, and after that I request everybody to jot down their questions and put them into chat box, so that in case you want to know anything from the respective speakers, we can take them up during the question answer session. so that we can, the discussion becomes lively. Now over to Dr. Kunal to start with his presentation of the management of diabetes in special situations. Over to Dr. Kunal Gupta, please.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Gupta. I'll be talking about management of diabetes in high-risk patients. I hope my voice is clear.
Oh, yes. Chris, very nice.
Okay. So, management of diabetes, obviously, we know that this is an increasing burden. And this is just a brief overview of what we are already facing and what we are going to face in the next 10 or 15 years. So, specifically, if you go to Southeast Asia, we expect almost a 74% increase in the burden of diabetes. Already it is something near 100 million, 70 to 80 million, and it is going to increase almost double up by 2045. So this is the kind of burden that we are going to face. Specifically, if you look at diabetes, then one in 11 adults is already a diabetic. What makes this situation worse is that one out of two adults are undiagnosed. So what we are facing is a burden of diabetes, which we are not taking proper care of, and there's a huge burden almost equal where we don't even know that they have diabetes. The patient does not know. Further, 3 in 4 people are living in low economic strata, so they are not they don't have access to high-end drugs. 10% of global health expenditure is spent on diabetes, and this is just diabetes, not cardiovascular disease associated and kidney and blood pressure. 1 in 13 would have impaired glucose, and this is very important because this is the burden we can reduce if we can prevent these impaired glucose tolerance people to turn into over diabetes. So this is a sort of a preventive medication target that we have. 1 in 5 people is going to be 65 year plus, again a very difficult group. There's a huge group of type 1 diabetes, and 1 in 6 live birth is going to be affected by hyperglycemia. So this is a huge burden that we are facing, out of which some are undiagnosed, most of them, and there is a huge burden which is lying in the pre-diabetic and is going to convert to diabetes over the next few years. Now, specific to India, we already have about 88 million, out of which about half of them are undiagnosed, less so in the urban area and more so in the rural area. India is already home to the second largest population of diabetes, and it won't be long when it becomes the diabetes capital, or we already know it is the diabetes capital. So the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes is intermingled between genetic predisposition, environmental and lifestyle choices. Now, genetic predisposition, there's hardly anything we can do right now. There's nothing available to do this, take care of this. But environmental factors and lifestyle choices are something which has to be targeted. And this has to be done as a public health rather than as a personal patient target. Now, going to the natural history of diabetes. So the onset of diabetes, the day you diagnose diabetes, the patient has already been suffering from the effects of hyperglycemia for almost 5 years. So the fasting glucose, which was, say, about 10 years below 100, has already started to rise. And about 5 years before we diagnose as over diabetes, he's already started to cross the line and go into impaired fasting glucose or impaired glucose tolerance. So the patient of type 2 diabetes already has some sort of complication started. So you see, microvascular complication has started some 15 years ago, and microvascular has already started 5 years ago. With the onset of this impaired fasting glucose, not over diabetes, the beta cell function has already started to go down. Incretin effect has already started to wane. Insulin resistance has gone up. Initially, the insulin levels start to go up, but once over diabetes happens, they again start to fall, and this is the signal of beta cell failure. So this is a very simplistic view of the cause of diabetes: insulin resistant, incretin defect, and beta cell failure. But we know this is way, we are way beyond this, and it is more of an octet rather than this triple pathophysiology. So this is what was proposed in 2009 by DiFranzo. So there are 8 possible causes of this hyperglycemia. So insulin being produced less and insulin resistant are just one factor. The brain signaling the body that it is not full and you should eat more is an important factor. there is decreased renal glucose excretion, so the kidney is reabsorbing whatever sugar is being filtered. The liver is producing more of glucose. The gut carbohydrate delivery and absorption is impaired, and there is a very poor peripheral glucose intake. So all these factors, maybe a little less in some and more in some others, this is an octate which affects together to cause hyperglycemia and type 2 diabetes. Now, what is our goal? Once we know that this is a diabetes, we have to identify, and the goal for both pre-diabetes and diabetes is more or less similar. So we need to reduce the complication of diabetes. In pre-diabetes, we need to push back the onset of over-diabetes and if possible, reverse the diabetes. We need to decrease morbidity and mortality, improve quality of life. And all this is going to be achieved only when we achieve all the three targets, that is fasting, postprandial and HbA1c. So they're just targeting one, fasting or just HbA1c won't be enough. We need to target all of them. Now, with so many drugs available for diabetes, right from metformin, SGLT2, DPP4, GLP-1, sulfonylurea, we definitely need a guideline-directed therapeutic management. It cannot be a hit and trial, and it cannot be at the per choice of anybody. So it has to be guideline-directed. Now, the problem is that there are too many guidelines. The ADA has their own guidelines. The ESC has their own guidelines. And in America, ADA has one guideline and the AAC has the other guideline. So we need to follow a set of guidelines, possibly, to make sure that we deliver the best combination of drugs to the patient. And our goal should be to reduce the HbA1c to 7, if possible to 6.5, and in some cases to 8%. So this is the standard care of medical care of 2020, that is the ADA guidelines. ADA guidelines, the target of diagnosing diabetes has not changed. Fasting has to be more than 125. So anything 126 equal or more is defined as diabetic. That is after no caloric intake for at least 8 hours, that is fasting. Or you do an OGTT where you give 75 grams of glucose in about 200 ml of water. And then you check the sugar after 2 hours and it should be more or equal to 200. You can do an HbA1c, it should be 6.5 or more. So the reverse is true, less than 6.4 will not qualify for a diabetic, maybe for a pre-diabetic. And in case the patient comes with symptoms of hyperglycemia, then any random sugar of more than 200 qualifies for being a diabetic. So the change in the diagnosis has not been there in 2020. So this is just the comprehensive plan that we need not go into the details of this slide. But basically, you need to assess the patient characteristic. You need to consider what sort of treatment you want to give. You need to be sure that the patient can accept it. You want to give GLP-1, the patient may not accept the cost or the injection. Whether he accepts the insulin or not, whether he will accept the SGLT2 side effects of urinary infection or polyuria. So there has to be a comprehensive plan between what you can do, what the patient can do, and what are the characteristics. So if you go to the guidelines, they have divided all the drugs as per their characteristics. So first is the efficacy. Obviously, you would want to have a high efficacy drug. Second is hypoglycemia. So having no hypoglycemia with a drug is a very good choice when you're dealing with a patient who's mildly hypoglycemic and you want a tight control. Or you are dealing with an elderly, but you don't want to have tight control of his HbA1c. So having a non-hypoglycemic drug is a very important thing. Weight change. So either the patient is overweight, his weight is adequately controlled, or he is below weight. So you need to know which of the drugs cause loss of weight, which is neutral, and which can cause weight gain. Especially after EMPA-REG, this cardiovascular effect has got, this effects have become very, very important. So you either have a drug which is cardiac neutral. Obviously, any cardiac harmful drugs have been banned, so that they are not there. So either a drug is cardiac benefit or it is cardiac neutral. So a person who's already at high risk of cardiac disease or who's already suffering a cardiac disease, it is a good idea to add a cardio benefit drug. Same is with heart failure, especially with DAPA-HF. Now there is more and more data which is supporting drugs which favor heart failure. Obviously, this is SGLT2. Cost is a huge factor. We already saw 3 out of 4 diabetics are in a low socioeconomic status. So even though we may want to give them best of the drugs, they may not be able to afford it, whether they are oral or injectables. And just like cardiovascular effects, how do they affect the kidney, whether they are bad or good for the kidney? And there are some special consideration with almost all of the groups we need to see. So this is a comprehensive guideline of the ADA, where you divide the, you initially go with the patient with lifestyle changes, diet and exercise. You add metformin. It is here which I'll try to point out that the ESD has given up the first line therapy as metformin. So metformin is not a first line therapy as ESD, and probably the other guidelines will start reflecting that. But ADA still says first line therapy is metformin after lifestyle changes. Once you have these lifestyle changes, then you have to decide whether the patient is having atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease, he is having CKD or heart failure. If he is having one of them, then the next drug to add in this with metformin is either a GLP-1 or an SGLT-2. So an overweight patient with atherosclerotic disease, you would prefer a GLP-1. Only when the cost or whether the injectable is refused, you will go to an SGLT-2. In heart failure or CKD, it is SGLT2 which is the number one choice. Only if he is not willing for SGLT2 that you would go for a GLP-1 receptor agonist. But the important thing is that after metformin in an atherosclerotic or CKD patient, GLP-1 and SGLT2 become the number one choice. It is only when the HbA1c targets are not met in either groups that you start going to the other choices. That is, if the patient is not on GLP-1, then you can go for DPP-4 inhibitors, basal insulin. And what you will see is that sulfonylureas have become the last choice in this group. Although they are not overtly harmful, but given the benefits of the other drug, they have gone down the list. Now, if the patient is not having atherosclerotic disease, he is not having CKD or heart failure, then obviously you have this whole choice of drugs which you can give. The primary considerations in this choice of drug is whether you need to avoid hypoglycemia. So this would be a group of patients who's having recurrent hypoglycemia, or he is a patient who's elderly and you cannot afford to have hypoglycemia, or he's a cardiac patient again where you cannot afford to have hypoglycemia. Then the choice comes down to DPP-4, GLP-1, SGLT-2 and thiazolidine dione. So any of this you can add after metformin, provided he doesn't have atherosclerotic disease. Once he is not able to, his HbA1c is not, you cannot achieve the target, then the next choice again is one of these drugs which you have not used. Again, he is not able to achieve his HbA1c. So probably it is a good time to add sulfonylurea or an insulin. And that preferably should be a basal insulin. Again, if his basal fasting sugars are controlled and PP is not controlled, is when you add either a bolus insulin before meals or you go to a mixed insulin. Now, the next consideration, if you want to lose weight, then obviously, again, you go back to SGLT2 and GLP-1 because they are good weight benefiting drugs. Both of them cause weight loss. The flowchart remains same. If the HbA1c is not achieved, you go to the other choice and then the rest of the drug. Now, if cost is the major issue, then there are not many choices. DPP-4, SGLT-2 and GLP-1 all are costly, and we have to go to the older drugs, which is sulfonylurea and thiazolidine dione. So once you are not able to achieve them, then you probably jump directly to either the sulfonylurea, thiazolidine dione, which you have not used, or insulin. So this even though this chart looks very complicated, actually it has made it very simple. And once you get a hold of this chart, you know which drug to start with. In the end, once it is not controlled, you can go for any of the drugs. So pharmacological treatment, the therapy to glycemic treatment, is totally dependent on what the drug, what the patient profile is, rather than the drug. In case you need to intensify with injectable therapy, obviously, just as I discussed, you either add basal and then you go to a basal bolus, or you go to a mixed insulin. So this probably is a whole class of its own, how to go about adding insulin. Now, these people, as Dr. Makija already said, that blood pressure control is very important. So once you see a diabetic and you see that his blood pressure is uncontrolled, it is very important to target something like below 130-80. You start with one agent, If it is more than 160, 100, you start with two agent. If the patient has albuminuria, then you have to give him ACE inhibitors or ARBs. But if he doesn't have albuminuria, you can choose between ACE inhibitors, ARB, calcium channel blockers, or diuretics. But whichever you start with, in case the patient is not controlled, then you need to go to the second group of drug. So albuminuria, you need to add ACE inhibitors and ARB, and that is very important. So once you cannot achieve the control, I think we have already discussed this, how you go about adding another drug and probably add mineralocorticoid at one point and consider resistant treatment or difficult to treat patient. Now, additional cardiovascular indications obviously are when the patient is not controlled despite lifestyle modification. He already has an established atherosclerotic disease and he's already having some end organ damage. Again, so we now the new thing about cardiovascular is obviously this SGLT2 inhibitors. And this turnaround was after the EMPA-REG study, where there was both mortality benefit and there was, now that the data is coming about, the renal benefits and heart failure benefits. So even though they are a little costly drugs and they are not a number one choice for all the patients of diabetes, they are a most preferable choice for a person who is high risk of diabetes or who's a high risk of cardiovascular disease or already who has had a cardiovascular event. So other more than this SGLT2, there is a data about GLP-1 receptor antagonist, specifically liraglutide, which has continued to show some benefit in cardiovascular patients. But SGLT2, it appears to be a sort of a class group. Now, 2009 ESC guidelines talked about both diabetes, pre-diabetes and cardiovascular. So those were the ADA guidelines, and this is the 2009 ESC guidelines. 2020 will come a little later. So these are the 2019, where they divided the diabetic into three groups. One is a cardiovascular risk, all are the cardiovascular risk. One is a very high risk group, where the patient has diabetes and established cardiovascular disease and other target organ damage, or he has three or more risk factors, or he has a type 1 diabetes onset of more than 10 years. Now, the risk factor is that the patient is having elderly age, hypertension, dyslipidemia, smoking, or obesity. So in case he has three or more of this, or he already has an established target organ damage, so he falls in a very high risk group. High-risk group is a diabetic who's more than 10 years without target organ damage, but he may have risk factors which are 3 or less. Moderate risk is a diabetes less than 35 years in type 1 diabetes and type 2 less than 50 years with a diabetic duration of less than 10 and no risk factors. Now you see there is very high risk and moderate risk. There is no low risk. So just as Sir Dr. Makija said, that diabetic is to be considered as a cardiovascular event. So even if he doesn't have it, he already falls in a moderate risk group. Now in these, almost everything, ESC has guidelines, has almost targeted everything. BP should be systolic 130, diastolic around 80 or less. Glycemic control should be less than 7 for most of the adults. If you can, without causing too many hyperglycemia or hypoglycemic episodes, or patient does not have any comorbidities, preferably a young or early diabetic, so you target, you should pull down to 6.5. Obviously, this is only possible with drugs which do not cause hypoglycemia. And in an elderly or who's having too many comorbid conditions or who has limited life expectancy, the target can be relaxed to 8, in some cases even up to 9%. But not beyond 9%. Lipid profile in this high risk, very high risk patient, you should try to bring it down to less than 55 or at least less than 50% of the starting LDL. In patients of DM with high risk, your target should be less than 70 or again about 50% of your starting cholesterol if you cannot go below 70. And patients of moderate cardiovascular risk, you can target LDL of less than 100. Platelet inhibition is not for all diabetics as we thought a few years ago. So they are for high and very high risk group. Smoking is for anybody, diabetic, non-diabetic, hypertensive, cardiovascular. Physical activity is clearly defined. moderate to vigorous more than 150 per minute per week. So a cardiovascular exercise plus some amount of resistance training. So just running around is not going to help. You have to have some resistance training, and that should be about 3 times a week. Your weight target should be loss of at least 7%. So any overweight or obese patient should target 7%. Anything beyond that is all obviously going to help. And this should be based on calorie balance. Sometimes you require to add some surgical intervention. But as we see, SGLT2 and GLP-1 are good options when patient is not willing for the surgical intervention. Dietary habits, you need to obviously reduce the calorie intake, but the quality of carbohydrates, you need to add complex carbohydrates. You need to increase the protein, especially in the Indian diet where most of them are vegetarians. And you have to convert the quality of fat. Most of the time they are having saturated fats, and we need to convert it to monounsaturated fats. So it is just not reducing the calories. You need to make some changes in the dietary habits also. Now, this is if you see, there is not much of a difference between ADA and this ESE guidelines, except that if you see this A type 2 diabetes, that is the first flowchart. A is the first flowchart, is about drug naive patients. And in this, the patients, the same group we are talking about, atherosclerotic with the cardiovascular risk high or very high, that is CKD or maybe heart failure. So this patient, if he has this and he's drug naive, then you can straight away jump to SGLT2 and GLP-1 receptor antagonist. So you need not go through the metformin always. If you find that you need to give a cardio benefiting drug, so you jump to it. If they do not have this, then yes, obviously you go to metformin. And beyond that, you'll see that most of the guidelines are just as the ADA guidelines, that you switch to another drug or you add another drug. If you don't get an HbA1c target, you continue to add a drug or you ultimately add insulin. So this is the A group, which is drug naive. Next is obviously a drug patient who has already taken some drugs, and this usually would mean a metformin. So patient is already started on metformin. Again, you have to decide atherosclerotic disease or not. And if he's atherosclerotic disease, then on metformin, you will add SGLT2 and GLP-1. So this comes down to the same as what ADA advised. If the patient does not have cardiovascular risk, then you continue with metformin. But yes, your HbA1c target has to be met. And to choose the next drug, you probably need to go to the ADA guidelines and choose whether the patient is overweight, whether he can afford a costly drug, and whether hypoglycemia is a primary issue or not. And once you are not able to control, the last choice would always be an insulin. So ESC versus 2020 ADA guidelines, there are not very many differences in this. ESC says less than 7%. ADA says less than 7% for most adults. But sometimes you need to relax the target and you may need to tighten the target. ESC says blood pressure should be less than 130-80. ADA says yes, 130-80. But if it's lower risk, you can go up to 140-90. Lipid target, we already discussed. ESCs is very specific about very high risk, and moderate risk. ADA does not give very specific targets. It only asks us to lower the LDL. Antithrombotic, both of them agree. They are not supposed to be, they are not very strong recommendation unless the patient is in a very, very high risk group. Imaging, both of them agree that it routine asymptomatic coronary disease is not, is still a controversial issue. But ESC adds for calcium scoring of the patient if he's at moderate risk, if he has a high risk for CVD. So they do not significantly differ from each other, except that ESC has already started to go beyond metformin for monotherapy. Now, ASC guidelines are even more comprehensive because it talks about nutrition, lifestyle changes also. So do I have time, sir? There are just few slides left.
Fine, rush through.
Yeah. So it talks about nutrition in detail. You need to get an optimal weight. You need to reduce your calorie. What sort of high on polyunsaturated, monounsaturated fatty acids. So this is a much more comprehensive when you're looking at each and every level. It talks about physical activity, which is more or less the same, 150 per minute. walking, climbing stairs, running. There needs to be a strength training. You need to increase it as tolerated. It even talks about sleep. If you do not get 6 to 2 hours sleep, you probably need to refer to a sleep study, especially as sir mentioned about OSA that we need to take care of. There has to be a behavioral support, community engagement, alcohol moderation. So this is something which is different from the other guidelines. They talk about alcohol also. And there is no doubt about smoking cessation. Everybody talks about it. But they suggest that you can go for nicotine replacement or any medication which will help you in this smoking cessation. So evaluation for complication, you divide it in BMI of more than 25, less than 25. This is a little higher for Western population. About 1.5, it is lower for Indian population. You treat atherosclerotic disease. You look at dyslipidemia and hypertension. You take care of weight loss therapies. The target should be normal glycemia. They will probably go towards overglycemia. In the weight loss therapies, they have mentioned about a few drugs, orlistat, lorcaserin. Lorcaserin has been already been withdrawn from the market. Phentermine, topiramate, most of them is not available. Liraglutide is available, but liraglutide in India is still not indicated officially for weight loss. But yes, person who's already having morbid obesity is a good candidate for bariatric surgery, both for diabetes control and weight control. And then you need to proceed, obviously, for this glycemic control. Now, in AAC, that their fasting glucose target is 100. PPG is more than 140. That is the target for hyperglycemia. Then there is a diabetic, low risk and a multiple diabetic criteria where you just start with metformin, acarbose, and try to lose weight. And you may add thiazolidine, diones, GLP-1. So in hyperglycemia, probably ADN and this ESC gives a better guideline. So this lifestyle modification is a huge emphasis on AC guidelines. Lifestyle therapy, lipids, statins, at what level you need to add, very high, and what are the targets. This talks about, and your systolic and diastolic goal in hypertension should be less than 130, which is more or less similar to all the other guidelines. So in this HbA1c, in this, the diabetic medication is not well defined in the AAC. It talks about monotherapy where it underlines metformin, but it agrees GLP-1 and SGLT-2 can be a choice for metformin. And once you go beyond monotherapy, you can choose any of the drugs for dual therapy, then triple therapy. And what it advises specifically is that every 3 months you need to evaluate your blood sugar control and titrate your drugs till you achieve the set target. So again, this talks about how to intensify and add insulin at each level, and this we can take in a detail group. Again, the profiles of anti-hyperglycemic medication is more or less the same. Instead of those cost and height and weight, they have almost the same criteria, and they have added for ketoacidosis, especially with the SGLT2. Now, all three guidelines, once you go through all three guidelines, and you can choose to take up even a single guideline. You don't need to study all the three guidelines as long as you follow some guideline. So the idea is to have a tight glycemic control, which minimizes long-term micro and macrovascular complication without having short-term complication like ending up in ketosis or hypoglycemic admissions to the hospital. Your targeted HbA1c goal has to be titrated as per the patient profile. So don't be rigid about 6.5 or 7. The patients may sometimes need to be targeted about 9. There are multiple OADs which you have to decide, which the patient profile has to be, you have to judge on it, and the patient choice as well. You need to add insulin therapy, and you have to go through a sort of a stratified plan. How do you add insulin and how do you go about titrating it? From clinical evidence, is concluded that HbA1c can be achieved by dual or triple combination, especially in the first 10 or 15 years of most of the diabetics. With the combination already, type 2 diabetics are deprived from early effects or drawbacks of insulin therapy. So hitting her early and using a combination really pushes back the need for insulin therapy. And as long as your HbA1c is controlled, it does not matter, really matter whether you have added insulin therapy or not, especially in patients who do not have too many comorbidities and who are early part of diabetes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Kunal. You had an exhaustive presentation. I think you must be.
I think we can have this presentation in three talks rather than one talk, sir.
What is the matter? But he had covered nearly all the things and two guidelines in exhaustive manner, and he had compared them beautifully. I think he deserves a big hand, and he has been very exhaustive and very thorough. Now I set the ball rolling. I first go to Dr. Makhija. Dr. Makhija, you said that there are resistant hypertension, we decide, and three drugs have been used, and the blood pressure goal is still not met. I would like to add that it is to be said resistant hypertension only when maximal doses of three drugs have been used, and despite that, the drug, the hypertension goal is not achieved. And very well, you rightly pointed out that the office blood pressure measurement versus the home blood pressure measurement versus the ambulatory blood pressure monitoring, the all goals are slightly different. It is slightly high for the patients who come to the office of the doctor, and those who are monitoring at home, the blood pressure goal is to be slightly kept low. It is 135 by 85, while in doctor's clinic it is 140 by 80, and at home it is 130 by less than 130 by 80. That's so far true. Dr. Makhija, I would like to ask you one question. At times, our physicians are not able to decide from the clinical signs, because they are dealing with the secondary hypertension, that is the secondary, one of the secondary causes of the hypertension, or it is the essential hypertension. Can you please enumerate features, the clinical features by which they can early decide that this is their secondary hypertension and investigate accordingly, particularly the role of obstructive sleep apnea and the primary hyperaldosteronism, which at times go missed because of subtle signs. Dr. Makhija, I just unmute you. Fine.
Day-to-day OPD settings. I'm still there.
Dr. Makhija, you kindly speak.
Yeah. So, first thing is, on the basis of once you see the patient, you have to decide. One thing very important to rule out is you have to take the history of OSA, not from the patient but from his attendants, especially from a spouse, or if it's a female, from the husband. If there's a history of snoring, we think the patient is obese, then OSA is a very common entity which is often missed, and that needs to be investigated through a sleep study. Secondly, if though not sometimes possible in a busy OPD practice, but especially if you're seeing the patient for the first time, especially if it's a young patient, you should try and feel both the upper limb and the lower limb pulsations, and that way you can get an idea. You can sometimes, or maybe if you're careful enough, rule out at least coarctation or some vasculitis, large muscle vasculitis, etc., which are another common cause of secondary hypertension. Thirdly, you have a look at his normal routine profile, the blood investigation, which normally most of the patients do get it done. It's a list of investigations, the routine CBC, KFT. KFTs are very important. If the patient shows even a mild renal derangement, slight rise in creatinine, or the patient has a persistent hypokalemia, the patient is fluid overloaded, or the patient has sudden repeated episodes of accidental hypertension, then you should always rule out the causes, especially secondary hyperaldosteronism, hyperaldosteronism, the Cushing's, as well as the pheochromocytoma. These are things which are often underdiagnosed and missed in the initial settings. And one more thing, which is a clue that if the patient has even a mild asymmetry of the renal size on ultrasound, or when you start the patient, especially on an AS or an ARB, and there is a rise in creatinine. And these are certain clues that the patient might be having renovascular or a renal parenchymal disease, and one needs to investigate them, because once the patient is labeled as hypertensive, then the patient is going to get the hypertensive medications for the rest of his life. And these are few conditions. If we diagnose them early and treat them, then the patient will be free of hypertension for the rest, at least for a majority of his life.
That's really wonderful. So we have a combination of palpitation, perspiration, pain and pallor. In case you find that the patient is having hypertension and he's having pallor, and then one must always look for, one must immediately look for the kidney. In case the patient is having palpitation and patient is having headache and perspiration, one may always to go towards the diagnosis of hyperosmolaritis. And if patient is obese, has history of snoring, and the hypertension is labile, sometimes going down, sometimes going up, then one has to always look for the obstructive sleep apnea and the auditory study accordingly. And Dr. Makhija, I just wanted to add, you said one of your slides showed that the role of beta blockers in pregnancy. When do we use beta blockers in pregnancy? And before I go to that question, I would like to add that beta blockers, they may have a role in the obstructive sleep apnea cases who have hypertension, because the hypertension and obstructive sleep apnea is because of sympathetic overstimulation, and beta blockers, they are able to blunt that overstimulation drive. So these patients might be better benefited with the early addition of a beta blocker. And now coming on to the pregnancy with beta blockers, in what conditions do we use beta blockers? I think we use alpha and beta blockers together.
Yeah, we use them together, but beta blockers, otherwise they are considered safe in pregnancy, and they can be used at all stages of pregnancy. Usually the medications are started, if it's a pregnancy-induced hypertension, then it's usually started on second trimester onwards. First trimester, usually it's not a PIH, it's more of the patient has associated hypertension. But the current recommendations are that the blood pressure, the beta blockers can be given at all stages, whether alone or with centrally acting like alpha methyl DOPA in pregnancy. And there is some concern that it decreases the fetal movements and might interfere with the uterine contraction, but the long-term data has shown that that is not the case, and it can be used in all this, at all times of during the pregnancy.
So it is important that we start the patient with the other drugs other than the ARBs and the ACE inhibitors and the diuretics in pregnancy, and later on we add beta blockers in the last, not in the beginning, and the main choices remain the centrally acting antihypertensive agents. Now I come to Dr. Kunal. Dr. Kunal, can I ask you a question?
One of our
audience wants to know, what is the treatment of choice of for a patient who is having uncontrolled diabetes and who has microalbuminuria in the urine examination?
A patient who has albuminuria, obviously the first choice is choosing an ACE inhibitor or ARB if his BP allows you to do that. As per the diabetic medication, though, after this canagliflozin presented its studies, now it is almost beyond doubt that SGLT2 helps in slowing of this progression of kidney disease, and in some cases, not all, in some cases it might even reverse microalbuminuria, sometimes even macroalbuminuria. So if there is no contraindication to adding an SGLT2, so that should be a preferred diabetic medication to add in these cases. Obviously you have to rule out, SGLT2 is a little tricky drug. So once you rule out the contraindications of giving SGLT2, then it is a choice to add.
And especially when the remicliflozin going to be a slightly more less expensive drug and it is more affordable a choice, one can always start with in case it is a class. But do you feel that the reduction of microalbuminuria is related to the class effect, or do you feel that it is particularly?
Yes, sir. I was about to point that out. it appears to be a class effect because that is what the other drugs are showing, but specifically remigliflozin has not shown that data. But obviously it is a little early, and I'm sure the data would come up, because most of the effects of cardiovascular and renal appear to be a class effect.
That's very nice.
More or less everybody has shown some benefit, so we can expect that, sir.
And I think in case the patient has microalbuminuria, rather than choosing or particularly running after a special drug which might be more expensive, it may be important to emphasize that the patient has to control the diabetes, bring down the HbA1c.
Absolutely.
So that the kidney disease in itself gets controlled and does not progress that fast. And now I come on to the lifestyle changes, which are nearly common to both the entities, hypertension and diabetes. Arun, can we go on to for about 5 minutes more?
Yes, sure, sir, sure.
I would like to emphasize upon the lifestyle changes because they are common, and most of the physicians and busy practitioners do not emphasize the lifestyle modification to the patient, and patient, once having paid the consultation, is not interested to listen to the lifestyle modification because it is slightly difficult to adopt and difficult to change. But Corona has sold a lot of things to the world, and hypertension and diabetes both are the lifestyle diseases, and both advocate the exercise, the role of exercise, and the exercise is really 30 minutes per day for about 5 days a week. And once somebody does an exercise, it brings down the blood pressure by, say, 8 to 6 millimeters of mercury, and that effect lasts for about 22 hours. And if the patient is able to repeat the exercise on the next day, then the effect is long-lasting. And similarly, the role of diet, everybody wants to know what is the role of diet. Everybody wants to cut down on the sweets in diabetes, but one does not really know what is to be taken. Most important thing to be taken is, this is the plate, this is the concept of plate, and I'm going to show it to my viewers. This is the concept of plate, and this is the way I try to show it to all my patients, that their plate, 9-inch plate, should carry the vegetables, the cereals, less of dairy products, and mainly the fruits and the whole grains and other things. Similarly, for the patients with hypertension, everybody is after the salt, but nobody is realizing the importance of cutting down the saturated fatty acids, adding on the vegetables, the fruits, and people are just wanting to cut down the salt. People are after the sodium, potassium salts and all these things. Cutting down the salt is going to decrease the blood pressure by 5 millimeters of mercury, but in case somebody is taking not a good diet, then the blood pressure control cannot be undone even by the good exercise. So the diet is the most important thing. And if a proper diet is taken, then it is going to bring down the blood pressure by, say, 12 by 6 millimeters of mercury, which is one of the most important parameters, lifestyle modification parameters, to bring down the blood pressure or diabetic control. And next on, coming on to the smoking cessation, which also has an effect in controlling blood pressure and diabetes both, and alcohol cessation, those especially the alcohol containment. It is important those patients of hypertension who want to take alcohol, they should stop taking alcohol, particularly soda, because soda has a lot of sodium in it. And if they continue to take it with water, then it is not going to be that harmful as it is going to be with soda. So this point should be always emphasized, and then cutting down to the salt. Dr. Kunal, what is the role of statins in the hypertension, in the diabetes? And Dr. Makija, I'm also going to ask you the same question. Should the patients with hypertension be given statins? Over to Dr. Kunal. What is the role of statins in the...
Sir, definitely. I think Dr. Makija already pointed out diabetes is a cardiovascular equivalent. They all deserve to have statin unless they are very young and have no risk factors. But we have to look at the LDL before we refuse anybody a statin. In case they do meet their targets, maybe you can delay the statin for a few years. But I think almost most of them would require statin. Sooner or later, we cannot let go of statin. Statin has to be there. Targets both by this ASC and ESC, both have very clearly defined targets for LDL.
Dr. Makia, what about your patients with hypertension? Do you like to give them statins?
Hypertension, as such, if it's a isolated hypertension without any risk factor, without evidence of any hypertensive mediated organ damage, then probably the general guidelines are applied. However, if the patient has associated comorbidities, then of course they tend to get the preference. Maybe in my opinion, if the patient is hypertensive and the diabetic, most of them will require statin invariably. And any evidence of CAD, CBD, again statins. But for a pure hypertensive who is well controlled, and then the primary primary prevention guidelines would they suggest, those have to be taken into account.
If a patient of hypertension is having hyperlipidemia or dyslipidemia, would like to add on to statins?
Of course, if the patient has dyslipidemia, then he qualifies for a statin. What I'm trying to say is that hypertension alone, probably without any evidence of any organ damage or risk factors, will not qualify for a statin. But if he has dyslipidemia, then of course he needs a statin.
That's great. And one last question which I'm going to put to Dr. Kunal is that what are the contraindications? You have told great about the indications, but a physician should be aware what are the contraindications, and one may end up in legal trouble in case somebody uses the drug, especially the metformin in the advanced renal failure and metformin in the advanced cardiac failure, and the SGLT2 inhibitors in the renal disease. And what are the other precautions that one physician should take while using any of these drugs?
Yeah, sir, obviously all the drugs have their own contraindications. Specifically metformin, if the patient is sick for any reason, he is vomiting, he has gastrointestinal symptoms, he should not take it. If he is having advancing, worsening kidney disease, he should not take it. If his creatinine is already elevated, it is a very bad time to introduce metformin. Somebody who is already taking it, you may take it up to at a level of 7 mg creatinine of 3. SGLT2, again you have to look at a number of things before you add SGLT2. Patient should not be having a recurrent this UTI or mycotic, genital mycotic infection. Even though there are a lot of data coming up with lower GFR, but still it is not as yet approved for GFR below 60 and below 45. So SGLT2 have to be careful. Again, it is not a drug to be given in a person who is insulin deficient or who is hypovolumic.
Yes.
So you can push a patient into non-ketotic, non-hyperglycemic ketosis. And again, euglycemic ketosis. And this is not a drug to be given again in patients who have already got a bone disease. It may increase fractures. Same is true with pioglitazone, glitazone. You have to look for bone strength. You have to see the patient should not be in cardiac failure. And you need to avoid weight gain. So pioglitazone is not a good drug. Sulfonylurea are usually safe, but the greatest drawback is hypoglycemia. Newer sulfonylurea, the second generation, are way better than the older ones. Still, we have to be a little careful, especially in the elderly or cardiac patients, about hypoglycemia. And same issues with insulin. Overall, they are a very safe drug. But insulin you should totally avoid in a patient you know cannot manage hypoglycemia at home. And even if you need to give insulin, you need to give very relaxed targets for sugar control. GLP-1 is more of a tolerability rather than a contraindication. But somebody who is not tolerating it, it is not wise to give GLP-1. Again, a patient who is vomiting and who has a good weight and is losing weight, again, not a good drug to give GLP-1. Except insulin and in some cases metformin, most of the drugs are not supposed to be given in pregnancy. And DPP-4 are generally safe. DPP-4, other than a patient having history of pancreatitis, you can give to all the patients with any comorbidity. most of the renal disease patients can tolerate DPP-4, except linagliptin and teneligliptin. You need to adjust the dose. In linagliptin and teneligliptin, you can give the dose, the same dose you can continue even in end-stage renal disease. So I think those few points that we have to look before prescribing the drug.
That's very nice. Thank you very much, both the speakers. And I hand over the mic to the Alchem Group, Mr. Arun Jain. Thank you, Arun, for inviting all of us. And over to you now.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to all of you for the wonderful session. On behalf of entire Alchem, all the audiences, I take the opportunity to thank Dr. S.K. Gupta for moderating the webinar and ensuring the audiences are enriched with the clinically relevant messages. We also thank Dr. Aman Makhija and Dr. Kunal Gupta for sharing their clinical experiences. We also thank you all the doctors who have joined this webinar. We at Alchem will continue to serve doctors and patients by making our brands available and good quality. Thank you. Have a good day.
Hi.
Thank you. Thank you.